Lord. We bless you. Thank you for covering us, Lord. Thank you for causing us to sleep in peace. We rested yesterday night and you kept us in peace, Lord. Thank you. Just tell the Lord thank you. Thank you for this morning. Thank you that we shall encounter you, because you said that where two or three are gathered in your name, you are there. Lord, we bless you. Just thank the Lord. Thank the Lord. We worship you. We give you glory, Lord. You are worthy of all our praise, Lord. You are worthy more than words can describe. You are worthy. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We give you glory. We enter your gates with thanksgiving in our hearts. We enter your courts with praise. We enter with thanksgiving. We give thanks. For you have said in your word that give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His mercies endure forever. We thank you, Lord, for your mercies that are new every morning. Thank you that your mercies are not only new every morning, but they endure. They endure with us. They endure with us through our trials, through our misdoings, Lord. Your mercies are with us every morning. And I thank you, Lord. Psalms 124 says, if it had not been the Lord who was on our side, let Israel now say, if it had not been the Lord who was on our side, when men rose up against us, then they would have swallowed us alive. When their wrath was kindled against us, then the waters would have overwhelmed us. The stream would have gone over our soul. Then the swollen waters would have gone over our soul. Blessed be the Lord who has not given us as prey to their teeth. Our soul has escaped as a bird from the snare of the fowlers. The snare is broken and we have escaped. Our help is in the name of the Lord. Will you just bless the Lord, because he has not given us as prey to the enemy's teeth. The enemy tried. The enemy is trying, because the Bible says that the enemy moves around like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. But blessed be the Lord. Verse 6 says, blessed be the Lord who has not given us as prey to their teeth. The Lord has not given us as prey to the enemy's teeth. Thank the Lord. Thank him. Thank him that he has not given you over to the enemy's plans. Though the enemy tried, though the enemy went to seek for us, but the Lord, blessed be the Lord, who has not given us as prey to their teeth. Lord, we thank you. Thank you for preserving us from the desires of the enemy to swallow us. Thank you that you have not given us over to the enemy's desires to finish us, Lord. We thank you. We come with thanksgiving from our hearts, O Lord. We come with hearts of gratitude, mighty God. We come lifting up our hands to you, saying thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for the times you have warned us of impending danger. You have warned us, Lord, when we were about to do a mistake. You convicted us through your Spirit. Blessed be the Lord who has not given us as prey to their teeth. Blessed be the Lord. Verse 7 continues to say, our soul has escaped as a bird from the snare of the fowler. The snare is broken and we have escaped. Continue to thank the Lord because he has caused us to escape. That the Bible says that the Lord will not allow you to be tested beyond what you are capable of. The Lord did not allow us to be tested beyond what we were capable of. Thank you, Lord, because our soul has escaped. We have escaped from many things. When the enemy came in like a flood, Lord, we thank you that you raised up a standard against him. We thank you, O Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you that my soul has escaped like a bird. My soul has escaped like a bird from the snare of the fowler. When the enemy set up snares and traps against me, Lord, I thank you because my soul escaped like a bird. I thank you, Lord, for preserving me. Thank you for the gift of life. Thank you for giving me not only life, but life in abundance. Oh, continue to thank the Lord. Thank the Lord, for it is God's will for you in Christ, for you to give thanks to the Lord. Lord, we thank you. We thank you. We bless your name. Give thanks to the Lord. Give thanks to the Lord. We thank you. We give you thanks. We give you thanks, Lord. We give you thanks for preserving our children, for preserving blessing our relatives, Lord, for preserving us, mighty Father. We thank you. Thank you, Lord, for the fiery trials that you allowed to come through us, oh God. We thank you for taking us through the waters, because your promise remains that you say when you go through the floods, it will not overpower you. When you go through the fire, it will not burn you. We thank you. Thank you for allowing us to go through the fire. Thank you for allowing us to go through the flood, because through that, we have seen your promises true, that they have not overpowered us. We have not been burnt. We thank you. Blessed be God. 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 We worship you. Verse 8 says our help. Before that, verse 7b says the snare is broken. Not only did the Lord cause us to escape like a bird, but he made sure that the snare is broken. Thank the Lord, because the snare is broken and we have escaped. We have escaped from the teeth of the enemy. We have escaped from the plans of the enemy to do us evil. The Lord has turned it around. We thank you that you have broken every snare. That Colossians chapter 2 says that every handwriting of requirements that was against us has been nailed to the cross. We thank you that not only has our soul escaped, but the snare is broken. Thank you that the snare of sin is broken in my life. Thank you that the snare of sin is broken. We thank you, Lord, for the blood has broken the snare. The snare has no power. Thank you for the anointing. You say in your word that the anointing, it is the anointing that breaks the yoke. Thank you for the anointing that is present for your church to break every yoke. Thank you that yokes are breaking. Thank you. Thank you, Lord, that yokes will break in the name of Jesus. We thank you that every yoke shall break in the name of the Lord. We worship you. Verse 8 continues to say, our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made the heavens and the earth. Lord, we thank you. And Father, we ask for your forgiveness. We ask, Father, that you will have mercy on us for the times we have depended on our own strength. We ask that you will forgive us, O Lord. We ask that your mercies be made fresh this morning. Forgive us for the times we have depended on man, because you have said in your word that cursed is the man who puts his trust in a man. We say again that our help, my help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. Thank you for being my present help. Thank you for being my present help in time of need. You have been a present father. Thank you for being a present father for me, Lord. You have been very present. You have never left me, Lord. Thank you for never leaving us, never forsaking us. Your promise has remained to be true, that you will never leave us nor forsake us. Oh, we bless you. We bless you, Lord. Just bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. I will bless the Lord. I will bless the Lord, for my help is in the name of the Lord. My help is in the name of the Lord. My help is in the name of the Lord. Psalm 46 verse 1 says that God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore we will not fear, even though the earth be removed and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea. Thank you, Lord, for you are my refuge and my strength, a very present help. You have been a present father for children. You say that, Lord, you are a father to the orphans. You are the husband to the widow. Lord, we have seen that among your people. Thank you for being present, Lord, in our troubles, Lord. You are present. We bless you, Jesus. Hallelujah. We worship you. Let your name be glorified, O Lord. Receive our worship this morning. Receive our thanksgiving this morning. Receive all that we are this morning as we lift up our voices to you. May you arise in the midst of your people. Let your promise be true again, where you say that the Lord inhabits the praises of his people. May you inhabit our praise this morning. We worship you, Lord, and we adore you, Father. In Jesus' name we have prayed. In Jesus' name we have prayed. In Jesus' name we have prayed. Amen.
As even as we continue in the same mode of prayer, may we just arise even as we want to worship the Lord. And Father Lord, we exalt you this morning, King of Kings. We give you glory and we give you honor, O Heavenly Father. We praise your holy name, O King of Glory, my Redeemer. He that came to the earth, King of Glory, my Lord, Father, and you died for us, O Heavenly Father, Lord, we exalt you. Father, we give you praise and we give you honor, O Lord, King of Lord. Father, we commit our hearts, O Lord, before you, O Heavenly Father. He that is the light of the world, O Lord, King of Lord, my Redeemer. And somebody just go before God and commit your heart to him. And just tell him that here I am to worship you, O Heavenly Father. Here I am, O Lord, to exalt you, O King of Glory, Adonai, my Lord. Father, we give you praise, O Heavenly Father. We exalt you, O King of Glory, my Redeemer. Father, we avail our hearts, O King of Glory, Lord, before you, O Lord, to worship you, to worship you, Father, to worship you, and Father, just to worship you, King of Glory, to worship you, to worship you, to worship you, to worship you.
Be careful.
exalt him. Oh, humbly you came. Somebody just tell Lord, here I am to worship, here I am to bow down. Lord, here I am to say that you're my God. Lord, here I am.
Here I am to bow.
Come, Lord, I'm here.
Here I am to bow.
Lord, to bow down to you, O Lord.
Here I am to
say that you're my.
your eyes upon the Father. Gaze your eyes upon the Lion and the Lamb. He's worthy to be exalted. He's worthy of all praise. He's worthy of all honor and adoration. We have just sang that all praise belongs to Him. And I invite us, church, to just gaze upon the Father and give Him all the glory, all the honor and adoration. Come on, lift your voice to Him. He deserves it. He deserves all worship and honor. And Lord, we worship You this morning. For You alone are worthy to be glorified. You are worthy to be magnified. You are worthy to be exalted. You are worthy to be lifted up, oh God. You are God all by Yourself. None can be compared unto Thee. My Father, we bless Your name. For You are a mighty God, the mighty man of war, the mighty man in battle. I bless Your name, for I can trust You. I bless Your name, for You can be trusted. Your word tells me that those who trust in the Lord shall never be put to shame. And so, God, here we are to say thank You that You have held us. You have been with us, oh God. Blessed be Your holy name, oh God. Blessed be Your holy name, oh God. We lift up our voices in humble, O King of glory, adoration, declaring, holy, holy, holy are You, Lord God Almighty, the great physician, the great I am. You are Jehovah Jireh, the air that we breathe. We give You praise. We give You praise. For there is none like unto Thee, O God. We come before You to worship Your name. Thank You, oh God. Your name has been exalted above all, that at the mention of Your name, every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that You are Lord. And here we are confessing and declaring that You are Lord. You are Lord. You give life. You give life unto us. You are love unto us, oh God. We give You all the glory and honor. For there is none like unto Thee. So be praised in this place. Be glorified in this place, O God. May our worship rise to You and be accepted unto Thee. We give You glory, God. We give You glory, God. We give You all the glory, Jesus. You give life. You are. Light to the darkness, You give hope, You restore every heart that is broken. Great are You, Lord. Amen. Come on, just start to your neighbor and welcome them to church. Tell them, karibu kanisani. Welcome them to church. If you came with the person seated next to you, find another neighbor and tell them, welcome to church. Hallelujah. The Bible says, David said, I was glad when they told me, let us go into the house of the Lord. And we want to praise the Lord, the great and mighty God. Strong and mighty is his name. Are you ready? Let me see you clap to Jesus. You know this song. I want us to sing together. Are you ready?
Yeah, yeah.
Almighty God, my Redeemer, my hiding place, my self-refuge. No other name like Jesus. No power can stand against you. My feet are planted on this rock, and I will not be shaken. My hope, it comes from you alone, my Lord and my salvation. Your praise is always on my lips. Your word is living in my heart, and I will praise you with a new song.
Soul will bless you,
come on,
Lord.
Come on, clap to Jesus.
My feet are planted
possible. All things are possible. All things are possible.
Oh, your praise is always on my lips.
Your word is living in my heart, and I will praise you in a new song. My song will bless you, Lord.
You fill my life.
You fill my life with greater joy. Yes, I delight myself in you.
Declare this. Are you ready? You fill my life with greater joy. Yes, I
delight myself.
Hallelujah. And I want us to praise him with this other song in your own way. And I want you to tell your neighbor, give me some space. I want to dance for the King of Kings. David danced and took out his royal robes and continued to dance to the Lord. And that's what we want to do for him this morning. Are you ready? Let me see you. Give me some confidence that you're ready to dance. Let me see you sway. I see some people with left feet around me. So prove them that you can dance for Jesus. Do it.
Worship team. Ladies and gentlemen, please take your seats. You're all seated, huh? Now, today is October the 6th. And it's in Judaism, this is the day of redemption. Therefore, let's appreciate that all the things we do here, the scriptures we read, the worship we do, is all towards redemption. Therefore, if you've never had a day where you mark and celebrate the work that God did to reconcile us with Him, this is the day that is marked in the Jewish calendar as the day of redemption, Yom Kippur. If you remember, in 1973, the Jews so celebrate this day that they usually don't go to war. But in 1973, a war broke out on this particular day, and from that day on, they're on high alert, and right now, they're at war. Let us continue to appreciate what God continues to do for many of us. Now, before we proceed further, there are many prayer needs. Unfortunately, I arrived for the service a minute or two before 10 o'clock, so I wasn't given a list of prayer items that I could bring forth on this particular day. So for me to go forward, I'll take the liberty, because Pastor Judy has given me that liberty to manage the time, to ask if any of you have particular prayer needs that you can bring before the King of Kings as we get into the service. Please project, and I'll try and register what you're asking. Or Judy, you'll record for me. Please. You've got a mic.
Should I stand?
That would make you very...
Good morning. Good morning, church. My name is Janet Onyango. You know my mother. she's more regular here than I am. And you know my nephew, Kwe. He's also more regular here than I am. I am here just to ask you for prayers for my father, who is in hospital right now in South Africa. He had surgery a few days ago. It was very risky surgery, but thank God it went well. The doctor says it was successful. But he's recovering in ICU at the moment, and I'm asking for prayers for that he continues to recover. Thank you.
Thank you. We shall do. That's right.
Praise God. I think I'm the most known, eh? Because I stand there most of the time. So my son, Leshan, you all know him, he's not feeling well. Today, we have been on and off to the hospital the whole week, and we were expecting him to join us. But apparently the dad called, and he's rushing him again to the hospital. So please pray with us.
Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Ruth. I want to ask that we pray for, even as we pray for what is happening in the Middle East, because what happens in that place, it always ends up in Kenya. We also want to pray for our country, because the direction we are going, not only politically, but also in terms of worship, the freedom of worship, and all those other things. Oh, we are heading the wrong direction. Let's pray. Let's commit our country and also the global scene to the Lord.
Good morning, church. My name is Martin Carey, and as a defiant optimist, I would like to invite the church in having a prayer of thanksgiving. My wife is now an author. Her book was released yesterday. So that's our thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. Is there another? Last one? Benjamin. Come share my mic.
surprised the way people are looking at pastor asking for a prayer request. I have a prayer request. My wife came home yesterday from a meeting that they were having as ladies, and she's not been feeling well throughout the night. I continue to ask for your prayer, that you pray for her, that she'll get better. That's why she's not here today. But also pray for me for a few minutes, what will be happening. Thank you.
Thank you, Pastor.
Thank you.
Pastor Judy, please come and pray for us.
We can bow our heads in prayer. Lord, we thank you for these five prayer needs that have been placed before us and before you. Lord, we thank you that when we call upon your name, you hear us. And Lord, we thank you for Mr. Onyango. Thank you for his life. Thank you that you knew him before he was formed in his mother's womb. And thank you that we prayed for a successful surgery. And thank you that you heard us. And now as he recovers in the ICU, Lord, we ask for total recovery in the name of Jesus, that he will be healed from the top of his head to the soles of his feet in the name of Jesus. We trust you as our healer, Jehovah Rapha. We continue to thank you for Helen Kilusu and her family, O God. We thank you for their son, Leshan. We pray for healing over him in the name of Jesus. Lord, we pray that everything will work according to pattern, like you created his body in the name of Jesus. Anything that is ailing him, Lord, we look to you for healing in the name of Jesus. And we pray that the family shall enjoy the peace that surpasses human understanding. As the dad rushes Leshan to the hospital, we ask for the doctors, give them wisdom, O God, give them strength as they work on him in the name of Jesus. We continue to look to you for the sake of the global, our global world, O God. Lord, we ask, O God, that you shall reign your peace over the different nations in the name of Jesus. Lord, you have told us that unless you watch over a city, the watchmen watch in vain. And so, Lord, we look to you, the great watchman. May you watch over this globe. May you watch over the Middle East. May you watch over our country, Kenya, in the name of Jesus. May everything work according to your will in the name of Jesus. Lord, we pray for our leaders. We pray, O God, that they shall submit to the lordship of Jesus Christ in the name of Jesus. We pray that let there be light over this nation in the name of Jesus. And Lord, we thank you and we come to give you thanks like the one leper over Kit Kiarie's book launch in the name of Jesus. We pray, O God, that as she has begun this journey, O God, may it be a success in the name of Jesus. And we thank you that her labor of many days writing this book is not in vain. So, Lord, may you have your way, O God, and we thank you. We thank you that this book is done, O God. We pray that it shall be a blessing to many who read it in the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you for Pastor Benji's family. Thank you for the blessing that they have been to the body of Christ. Thank you for Nancy, O God. Lord, we ask that you will stretch forth your healing over her in the name of Jesus. Lord, we ask, O God, that she will enjoy total healing and recovery in the name of Jesus. May you look upon her with your mercy and your grace, O God. We thank you also for Pastor Benji, who will be bringing forth your word a few minutes from now. Lord, we pray for your strength. We pray for your wisdom. We pray that your voice will be very near and clear to his heart. We thank you and we honor you. As we continue with the service, be honored, be glorified. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Judy. Is Jubilani Mwangi with us? Jubilani, to help you be identified as Jubilani, I'll suggest you do this, and then you recite.
Good morning, church. I'm going to share the verse, Mark 1:1-11. It says, as they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethage and Bethany, Jesus sent his two disciples, saying to them, go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you find a colt tied up there, which no one has ever ridden before. Untie it and bring it here to me. If anyone asks you why you're doing this, tell them that the Lord needs it and will send it back here shortly. So they went and found a colt tied there. And as they were untying it, some people standing there asked, what are you doing untying the colt? And they answered, just as Jesus told them to, and the people let them go. When they brought the colt to Jesus, they put their cloaks over it, and he sat on it. People spread their cloaks and on the road, while others spread branches which they cut from the fields. Those who followed and went ahead said, Hosanna, blessed he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is he who comes in our father, the kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest. Jesus entered Jerusalem and came to the temple. Once he looked at everything, and since it was already late, they went to Bethany with the 12. Thank you.
Thank you, Jubilani. Well done, Jubilani. We have children among us, huh? I'm told your Sunday school teachers need you to go to class. This one is... So, can I ask the children to stand so that we can release them to go to Sunday school? And their teachers. We only have three teachers. Let's pray for the children and their teachers. Father, we thank you for these moments when we give attention to our children so that, Father, they may grow in your image and in understanding you and your ways. So, Father, bless them as they go to meet and to discuss matters that will touch their lives today and always. So, Father, bless the teachers to have the wisdom to communicate this and the children to absorb this. For we have prayed in Jesus' name. Children, please exit. Media team.
Welcome to Nairobi Baptist Church, Westlands. Thank you for making time to attend our Sunday service. To all our visitors, welcome to the family of NBC Westlands. A church that loves out loud. Our mission is to be a worshiping community of our Lord Jesus Christ that is advancing the kingdom of God through the power of the Holy Spirit. We're glad you're here and shall endeavor to know and love you more throughout the month. The following are our notices and upcoming events. Our virtual prayer meetings are every Thursday at 6 p.m. on Zoom platform. Join us as we spend time in prayers and petitioning God over different issues. By prayer, we can move mountains. Zoom link and passcode are circulated via our WhatsApp groups and the church's social media page. Are you interested in serving the Lord in musical worship? Then kindly sign up with Tim Biffin after the service. Are you interested in teaching and nurturing the next generation of NBC Westlands? The Children's Ministry is appealing for more volunteers to serve in the ministry. Are you the one? Please get in touch with Pastor Benjamin Angina after the service or register at the info desk. All church notices are sent to the official church WhatsApp group, which you can join by using the link provided by the church office. We have a love box for assisting the needy amounts. You can give in cash via the M-Pesa payment number 918-367, count love. Or in kind, dry foods can be delivered to church office at Gesha. We appreciate your generous giving and appeal for more support. One of the areas we seek to grow this year is fellowship in small groups. Already, many believers are finding growth, meaning, purpose, and identity in our small group ministries. If you're located in one, please visit our information desk or call, SMS, or even WhatsApp 0740-410-644. That is 0740-410-644 for placement. Join us tomorrow as we continue with our 2024 NBC Bible Reading Marathon from the New Testament. This week, we are covering Hebrews chapter 7 to 13. You can like us on Facebook at NBC Westlands. Like us on Instagram at NBC Westlands. Watch some of our previous messages on the NBC Westlands channel on YouTube. For any feedback and or any need, don't hesitate to reach us on 0740-410-644. That is 0740-410-644. These and other events taking place, kindly refer to Martin Church Bulletin and the official church WhatsApp group. In all seasons, we desire to continue growing into a Christ-like church that is building strong families and transforming nations. Have a blessed Sunday and a fruitful week ahead.
Greetings and praise God. My name is Daniel Kemboe. I'm a pastor at Nairobi Baptist. We are continuing with our Bible reading, and today we're reading from Hebrews chapter 1 to chapter 6. This is the reading of the week. And as I was reading the scripture, I realized that it talks about Christ as the image of the Father. He is greater than all angels and all prophets who preceded him, including Moses. Now, Christ is greater than angels and is greater than Moses. Why? Because of what he did. He came and he lived amongst us. He went through what we are going through. And because of that, he did not only go through what we are going through, but also he suffered death and he conquered death, offering great comfort and sincere. It's an encouragement to us that we have a high priest who can sympathize with our weaknesses and with our problem. This is Christ Jesus. The Hebrews puts it that people used to offer animal sacrifices in order for their sins to be forgiven. But as I said earlier, Christ came, lived, and died as a living sacrifice. So we don't need to offer more sacrifice because Christ did it once and for all. In chapter 5, it speaks about the Word of God. It says the Word of God is a living word. It's active. It's sharper than a two-edged sword. And remember the book of John. In the beginning, there was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. This is Christ. So there's a way that this book elevates the person of Christ. And us as believers, we have confidence in him. Just as you read through the book of Hebrews, you can see all the powers that has been bestowed in Christ. And that's why he said that in the book of Matthew chapter 5, verse 17, it says that, "Do not think that I came to abolish the law or the prophets. I did not come to abolish, but to fulfill the law." That's according to the book of Matthew, chapter 5, verse 17. So Jesus is the perfect sacrifice and was part of God's plan since the beginning of time. The proof is in the book of Matthew. And this is the high priest we are talking about. He expects us to live a life that is free from sin because he died for our sin. Thank you, and may the Lord bless you.
Please take note of those announcements, but I'm also asked to highlight the following. Jabali Convention is on the 30th of November, take time to understand what is involved here and maybe commit to attending. And then, congregants, unfortunately, yesterday I was in a meeting addressing the finances and accountings and the budgets that you're going to discuss in November. And unfortunately, we are very behind. So the church is right now under some financial stress, but notwithstanding, we must thank each and every one of you and all of us for what we are sacrificing to give in these challenging times. But the life of Christ and the life you chose to when you follow Christ is a life of sacrifice. So I'll just appeal to you to sacrificially give towards the operations of the church. Right now it's quite behind, it's holding back a lot of creditor settlements and also putting off some events that they had planned in the calendar. So please be and continue to be generous in support of the work of the church. Because of those who came before us, we're able to sit here and continue enjoying receiving the word of God because they sacrificed and gave so that we could hear the word. So let us also do the same for this present generation and the coming generation. So please give that. And even as I say that, I need to thank a family that has generously donated a lot of toys. There was an appeal for toys for the Sunday school. We still appeal for more to be given. Many of you here may have had toys when your children were smaller. Please retire the toys to the church so that other children can enjoy that. So there's a lot of ways of giving in support of the church. And this one, appeal for the toys, is one of those ways. So also, you know, Pastor Judy indicated that Pastor Benjamin will be giving the message today. He's involved with Sunday school, and he's appealing for more of us to get involved in Sunday school. So people who can engage with children, who understand children and can communicate or want to learn how to communicate and support that ministry, because there is where the future is. If we don't do well here, we may be the last generation. I always remember growing up, and there used to be a very famous evangelical called Francis Schaeffer. He wrote a book where he believed that maybe by the turn of the century, Christianity would not survive. It has survived because some people passed on the message to us. Some of us learned and then we passed on to others. So let us also volunteer to go forward and share this gospel with others as we go forward. So in the children ministry, there's an appeal for support in that regard. So stand up and take time to support. We talk of the love box. Now, many of you, if I may talk from my own household, we do have a lot of things that we really have a problem getting rid of. So if you're in that category, please just sort them out and come and give them out. Some people will find use for them. Clear your house. Clear the chatter in your house and give them away. Some of you are, your children have left home, you have outfits they wore when they were in school, they never use them anymore. Give them away. It will clean your house and also make you appear to be very generous, but they're actually helping you get rid of things you don't need. So you should also be grateful they're accepting them. So love box, please, generously give towards that. I'm told I'm engaged in some things, and sometimes you're told to dress formally and sometimes not informally. But I can tell you the number of days I actually put on a formal suit in a year are about, formal suits, maybe about 30 days in a year maximum out of 360 days. So gentlemen who have got excess suits and ties, donate them. Somebody might find it stylish to put on a suit every day, but I think there's a generation that, let's leave it at that. But I'm talking about gentlemen because I'm a gentleman, but if I look on the lady's side, it might be more excessive. So I'm also told to bring to your attention the Thursday service. Last week I sat to one of my the neighbor I sat in church actually was promoting that I should be there for the Thursday service. And I recorded it in my system to be part of this Thursday service. But when COVID came, a lot of meetings also happened about that time. People have, especially social meetings and events. I know even among you in the committees in church, you have virtual meetings in the evening. So maybe we should commit as a church that we should not have any other meetings at that hour. Cancel those ones. Then you should extend it to your business side and say, no business meetings on Thursday evenings. Then we can virtually all connect in. So please, commit to attending Thursday's prayer meetings. Talking and relating with God is really key to your growth as a Christian and having a complete understanding and having a complete life and understanding your purposes and drives. So please, let's make Thursday work for all of us and for our relationship with God. Without it, I don't think we feel the frustration of not moving forward. So please, Thursday, I appeal that we all commit, put it alarms on your mobile phones. When Thursday 6 o'clock arrives, an alarm goes off, you link in. Though, I must ask the management, last Thursday, the link was not posted unless I missed it totally, because I had committed to connecting, but I couldn't find the link. So let us maybe use a standard link so that no one has an excuse like I had for last Thursday. You see, the church is always developing leaders. And at this point, I will ask Pastor Judy to come forward. You have heard of 318. And those of you who are engaged in that program, there was a graduation ceremony yesterday. So basically, we don't lack leaders. We are always adding to the list. So Judy is going to award those who took part in the program.
I'm a soldier in the army, I'm a soldier in the army, I'm a soldier in the army, I'm a soldier in the army of the Lord. Amen. And that's really who we are as a church. So Genesis chapter 14, verse 14 says that when Abram heard that his relative had been taken captive, he called out the 318 trained men born in his household and went in pursuit as far as Dan. And we have had a privilege to have 318 programs run this is our third year. And we really bless the name of the Lord. If you're an alumni of 318, kindly stand. If you've gone through a 318 leadership program, kindly stand. Let's just celebrate them with a clap. Yes, these are trained men from our household. Thank you, you may have your seat. Abram trained his men of his household, and that is what we are doing as a church, and we thank God for these ones who were able to graduate yesterday. So 318, for those who are wondering, what is this 318? 318 is a leadership training of Nairobi Baptist Church. The name comes and is inspired from Genesis chapter 14, verse 14, which I just read, where Abraham was able to mobilize an impromptu army. So they were able to go for battle and they were successful and they rescued their relative Lot. And that is the idea we have as a church, because as different counties and as a country as well, we are always under attack. And it is important when the church is equipped properly to be able to rightly divide the word of truth, but also to be a light wherever we are. So what is this 318? What happens during 318? We have three modules that usually take place from the month of May, and the team gets to graduate in October. So these three modules are fashioned in a way that it's module one takes 6 weeks, then they take a break, then another 6 weeks, they take a break, and the last module again for 6 weeks, and then they get to graduate. And this 3-18 leadership program is designed to achieve different goals. The first one is to really standardize all of us as a community or as a church in the area of doctrine, so that we all believe in the same doctrine, and none of us is swayed away or none of us drifts. Then it also helps us with being able to practically engage in personal evangelism and discipleship, but also as a group where you are also equipped. How do you evangelize? How do I evangelize? How do I disciple younger men and women around me? And by younger, I mean in faith, those ones that you lead to Christ. How do you walk with them to a point where they are mature in the faith? Then it also helps us to be practical in missions and church planting. As a church, we know that we have been able to church plant. How many churches do we have so far? How many churches do we have? 6, yes, which have been planted by Nairobi Baptist Church. And the idea is to take you through, how do we do church planting as a church? What is the importance of church planting? And you get to know that during the leadership training. Then the last one is having a communal reading through the Bible. As you do 3:18, you get to read the Bible from Genesis to Revelation. That's a requirement. And now we have an idea, because as a church, we have been reading through the New Testament, which we are almost finishing. But as a 3:18 student, you get to go through the Bible as well. And hopefully, for those who have not been able to finish yet, you graduated yesterday. Please know that you've not graduated from reading through the Bible. So make sure you complete. And once you complete, feel free to go again and again, because this is a habit. And also it's a Christian requirement for all of us. So I'd like us to celebrate our group leaders. In this cohort, we had 3 group leaders. I'd like to just call them in front. Dr. Mwangi, Mr. Ngatia, and Livingstone Otieno. Let's just celebrate them as they come. Now, for those who have done 3:18, you know how rigorous it can be. And these three gentlemen and leaders in the church, they sacrifice their time, they sacrifice their resources, they sacrifice their energy. Remember, they are alumni of 3:18. So they got to do another 3:18. And so I'd like to welcome our chair of the Elder Scott to just give them this token of appreciation. It's really, whatever is inside here is really good. And we celebrate you, we honor you. Thank you for giving your time and your energy in the service of the Lord. God bless you. So I would like to call upon the different people who are able to graduate. You may have your seat. Thank you. Who are able to graduate from Livingstone's group. We have Eme Okishangane. Kindly, Eme. All right. So then we have Mary Mukami Kamau, Michael Kuria, Davis Sifuna, and Helen Kilusu. I think they're those ones who are yet to finish. They will recite. I'm sorry, I apologize for that. So, Helen Kilusu, kindly come and receive your certificate from Pastor Benji. Then we have, I'll just read all of them, despite of the group that you're from. Then we have Dr. Jackson Mainge. I'd like to invite a fellow elder to come and just celebrate our elder. Congratulations, Dr. Mainge. He's leading by example. So if you're an elder and you know you have not gone through the 318 leadership program, kindly plan to join us for 2025. Lona Mwangi, let's encourage her as she comes. And as she comes, we can have Gladys Gikonyo. Elder Bill, come and help me to just...
I'm just holding and passing.
Lona Mwangi, congratulations. Gladys Gikonyo, congratulations. John Moshiri, congratulations as well. Livingstone, congratulations. Victor Ngaiwa. Congratulations as well. Livingstone. Let's celebrate the Lord. If you saw him last Sunday, he had something. He was holding on to something after hurting his leg, and he's now okay. We thank God for you, Livingstone. Congratulations, our other elder, Davis Mulani. Congratulations. Thank you for leading by example. Thank you for showing us that it is possible to have different duties but still go through the program successfully. Thank you. Then we have Njeri Wakogi. Congratulations as well. She's part of our leadership in hospitality. We celebrate you, Njeri. Then we have Sheila Jemosop. Sheila Jemosop. Okay, she's not here, but I'd like to invite one of the ushers. She serves in the ushering team. You can just receive it on her behalf. Thank you. Then we have Mary Fine Okari. Mary Fine, congratulations. She just got a small baby, and she waded through until she finished. And yesterday she was graduating with her small child. So we thank God for you. Thank you for the diligence. Congratulations. Then we have Benjamin Sasimwa. Benjamin, congratulations. Interacting with many counties, traveling, but you still made it. Thank you. Then we have Esther Givinji. Congratulations, Esther. You made it. We have trained men in NBC Westlands, and we are very proud. We thank the Lord for all of you. So if you'd like to join the next cohort, kindly see me or see any of the people in the leadership, and we will be able to register you in this. So God bless you. I'd like to take it back.
Thank you, Judy. Now, that's Nairobi Baptist, developing leaders into the future. Please, those of you who have just graduated and been certified, let us see your leadership among ourselves here. Take the lead in things. Do not wait. Give us ideas. Do not hesitate. You have been certified as leaders, so do it. Huh? Now, in my early announcement, I had left out one thing. The youth, all youth, Yada, you have been asked to meet at the end of the service next to the keyboard so that you can have your discussions and plans of things you need to execute. And then, of course, this moment in Nairobi Baptist is always in every service. If this is your first time to attend a service here with us, please indicate it's your first time so that we can acknowledge your presence and also just record it. Please stand up and just take a moment to introduce yourself and give us some good tidings of that we can appreciate.
Hello, my name is Sheshaweta Singh. I come from Sri Lanka and I live in the Netherlands. I come to Kenya quite frequently. I'm here to join you.
Hello, church. My name is Janish Shwetasinghe. I'm Shesha's son. This is my second visit to Kenya. I was here in April as well doing volunteer work. I'm here again doing volunteer work and very much enjoying it. I was also invited to church by Selena. And yeah, I was in Kibera yesterday, all of the day feeding 150 kids. I'll be volunteering with farmers in Kenya, in Kisumu, and also with the Maasai village in Lolgorien. And I'm looking forward to seeing more and helping as much as I can with my skills in your beautiful country. Thank you.
Thank you. You may take your seats. But please, after the service, when we finish, please join us up front here for a cup of coffee, tea, water, or just your presence so that we can get to know you better and we can appreciate how your work has been with you until this point so that we can also impart some of our own experiences with you. Thank you for joining our service. I'm told if we don't say teenagers, they don't go out for their Bible studies with service. So if you're a teenager and you didn't hear me say, I said children and you said you're not a child, now I'm saying teenagers, if you're still in the room, there's a study for teenagers that is ongoing. So take the liberty to go now. I think that's the core of the business here. Now, our speaker today, we all know him. His name is Pastor Benjamin Angina. Now, if you many of you have been reading the scriptures, if you know the order of the children of Jacob, what number was Benjamin? Seriously, I said the order. No, you see, remember, in that order, the order is usually talking about the boys. Eh? There are girls in between. So, was Benjamin older than Diana? Dina? Was she younger? You guys, you know, reading scripture is very exciting. It brings out some things and you realize you're not just glossing over it. Now, we don't gloss over Benjamin. He is possibly the most influential person in this gathering of ours because he influences our children. And when they come home, they insist on some things. So when he gives us a sermon, let us listen. We might have a bigger impact with our children and also influence other children. Benjamin loves children. He has got three children, and as you heard, his wife is unwell. So basically, he's gonna talk to us about celebrating the Lord and King. He'll deliver it in a way that the Sermon on the Mount will come. Benjamin, welcome. Welcome and speak to your people. Let's pray for him. Father, we thank you that we have Benjamin among us and that you have given him your word to share with us and to encourage us. Lord, continue to bless the work of his hand, bless the walk he takes, protect him from all directions, give him wisdom, give him understanding, give him also the fear of yourself so that he may be able to do things much more beyond his own expectations and plans, so that you're able to see that all things he does will glorify you in all ways. For we have prayed all this in Jesus' name.
Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Let's just appreciate Elder. Okay, thank you very much for this privilege to bring to you the Word of God. My first few minutes at the pulpit here are usually very tense, and so I need your prayer so that we may be able to share God's Word. I'm privileged today to take us through celebrating Jesus as Lord and King. Celebrating Jesus as Lord and King. And so the Bible verse for today is Mark 11, 1 to 11. The one that was memorized today by Jabu. And really thank God for what our children are doing in memorizing scriptures. And I believe that that is giving us some sort of encouragement for ourselves also to try and do a little bit of that exercise so that we have the Word of Lord, of the Lord with us. And so in this portion of scripture, one of the things that we see is that Jesus is portrayed in his authority as Lord and King in an expected manner by the standard of this world, but in what was to fulfill the prophecy that was prophesied some years back when he rode on a donkey in Jerusalem. And those who had put their faith in him loudly celebrated him as a symbol of entry as a Lord and as King into the city, practically demonstrating their submission to him. That is what we are seeing here. But one of the things that I really thank God for is the privilege that God has given us this day, that we have his Word. We are able to see the beginning, Genesis. We are able to see the prophecy, and we are able to see now what is happening in the life of Jesus, and we even know what is to come. So we have the scripture that keeps on helping us to trust in the Lord and to keep on seeking the Lord. And so as we look into this wonderful topic that we were given, celebrating the Lord and King, one of the things that we need to seek God to help us understand is how do I view this King? How do I view Jesus? How do I see Jesus in my life? So that I may be able to celebrate him, not only when things are good, but to celebrate him all my life. And so the first topic here is Christ being revealed. And indeed, Christ as a King refer to the one of the three offices here that we are looking at when we are looking at the ruling power of Jesus himself. And that is, we are looking at Jesus as a prophet, we are looking at Jesus as a priest, but also today we are looking at Jesus as King. And so these three dimensions reveal both his person, who Christ is, and then it reveals his work, his mission here on earth. And it's important for us to understand that, because that is the only angle through which we'll be able to celebrate Jesus as indeed Lord and King. And so Jesus came as a King to us to subdue our rebellion. And that is actually one of the reasons why you see people celebrating here when Jesus is riding on a donkey. And then as a priest, he comes to deal with our sin. And we see him taking the role of dying on the cross for us, that we may have that salvation. And then finally, we see him as a prophet to deal with our ignorance, where now he's revealing to us who he is and the things pertain to the things of God. And so Jesus is revealed through the scripture with sufficient evidence of him being indeed the Son of God and the King of all kings. And so in the Old Testament, we see the prophecy being made in the common verse that we know, which is Isaiah 9:6. And here he's talking of, for to us a son is given, and the king and the government will be on his shoulder, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And in the gospel, is revealed. And John reminds us in John 4, 25 to 26, when Jesus is actually talking to the Samaritan woman, and one of the conversations that they are having is when this woman says that, I know Messiah called Christ will come. And when he come, he will explain everything to us so that we'll be able to understand who is this king. And at that particular point, Jesus revealed himself and he says, I, the one speaking to you, I am he. And then when you move to Acts, we see Acts remind us when now the preaching began and the Holy Spirit filled God's people. And we are told here that they are able to go to the end of the world to preach the gospel, being the witness in every part of the world. And then now when you get to Revelation, now he is expected to come again. And here again, we see the eternal rulership. No other kingship will come after that. In this kingdom, there is no impeachment. The king will remain the king. And Revelation 22:7 say, look, I am coming soon. Blessed is the one who keeps the word of the prophecy written in this scroll. So Jesus himself often spoke about the kingdom of God. And if you read the scriptures, that is always the main theme of the message that Christ actually brings to his people. He's preaching, he taught his disciples how to enter the kingdom and the kind of lifestyle that they ought to live in order for them to experience the entry into this kingdom. So this chapter ushers us into the last phase of Jesus' ministry, because immediately after this, the verses that follow, you see Jesus heading to his crucifixion. And now to demonstrate his kingship before his crucifixion, he rode on a donkey. There's a preacher that I once listened to, and I'm not going to mention his name. And at that time that I was listening to him, he was being interviewed by the media. And one of the questions that was being asked is that, because at that particular time, he was planning to purchase a new plane. And this was going to be his fourth plane. He had three. And so at that time when he was asked, why would you want to buy another plane instead of investing that money maybe to evangelism and so on and so forth? And his answer was very simple. In which I'm going just to quote what he said. That the Lord spoke to me when I bought the first plane. He spoke to me again when I bought the second one and when I bought the third one. And this time round, the Lord told me that this plane that you have, they're not moving fast. You need a new plane. And so ask the people of the Lord to clap for you and raise this money so that you can get a new plane. I hope you are hearing that. I need a chopper. So when all this conversation continued, he went into the scripture. And the scripture that he quoted was the scripture that we are looking at today. And he said, when Jesus was here on earth, he used a donkey. But he said that, I believe if Jesus was to be on earth today, he will not ride on a donkey. Jesus will take the first flight. And at that point, I just switch off from that media live stream. And you see, this is the same guy who once said that the reason why he can't take commercial plane is because commercial plane is full of bunch of demons. And so you wonder, as he stand before his people to make such a statement, and still people did raise money to buy that chopper, you understand why people perish for lack of knowledge. But as we look at this chapter, there's something special about Jesus. Why would Jesus pull such a stunt? Why would Jesus pull such a stunt to order for this donkey? You see, in the ancient Middle East world, leaders rode horses when they were going for war. But donkey, they would use when they were going for a peaceful mission. It represented humility. It represented suffering. And so again, you see when King Solomon is being appointed as a king, one of the things that happened, a donkey is brought. And this is mentioned in 1 Kings 1:33. Solomon riding on a donkey on the day that he was recognized as a king of Israel. And again, in Zechariah 9:9, this was also to fulfill the prophecy that had been said. Because remember, as you look through the scripture, everything that was prophesied about Jesus, as Jesus was revealed to us, everything was coming to pass. And people would actually look back and see the things that were said, and look now and see the things coming to pass. And so in Zechariah 9:9, we are reminded that the Bible talks of, "Rejoice, daughter of Zion. Shout, daughter Jerusalem. See, your king come to you, righteous and victorious, lowly riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey." And this is about a 1 year old of a donkey. And so what you see in the movie when Jesus is sitting on that donkey and actually his feet is touching down is actually the size of that donkey. It's something that is a donkey that has never been used. It was considered a good offering for that sense. And now in Revelation 19:11, now we see the other part of that story, which make me actually believe that if Jesus was living on earth today, he will not take that chopper. He'll still take a colt, a donkey. Because in Revelation 19:11, then we are told he will come on a horse because his purpose will be to judge rather than sacrifice. Because the sacrifice Christ offered once and for all. And so his coming back again will be to make judgment, and he'll be riding on a horse. Here we see Christ accepts him being celebrated as a king for the very first time. Because in many places you see Jesus avoiding this celebratory that people bring forth to celebrate him as a king. But at this particular time, for that short period of time, Christ actually allow people to celebrate him as king, to be recognized as king. And so we see a king who is able to see future. Because in a short while he's sending his disciple. And knowing his disciple, of course, they'll ask many questions. He says that, "I want you to go to the village that is not revealed to us. Say, I want you to go there. And you'll find a donkey there. And I want you to untie it because it is tied. And I want you to explain to those who will ask you the question of why are you untying this colt. Tell them the Lord needs it." He himself uses that word of Lord, accepting the kingship, the supremacy of himself as a king. And there are two things that I'm able to observe here. I don't know if you're able to see that. It's either the Lord actually did something in the hearts of those people who are watching that cult, or the owner, for that matter, of that cult, to the place that he had done something in his heart so that when they will see, when the disciple will go there, the two disciples that are not mentioned to us, when the two disciples will go there and untie the colt, and the owner will ask, or the people will ask, "Why are you doing this?" And they'll just explain the same thing that Jesus instructed them to do. The Lord needs it. The owner will not argue. They will not go into further conversation. It's just simple, release it. It's either something had happened in the hearts of those men, because in Proverbs 21:1, again, we are reminded that God is the one who channels the thoughts, the flow of the heart of a king. So he's able actually to control your heart and to do something that will make you release that particular cult at that particular time. Or number two, the owner, having lived in this village, understood the meaning of what Jesus was saying when he said, "Bring that cult to me. Bring the donkey to me." He understand what that symbolized. And to that end, he released it so that it will be going to perform whatever it needs to be performed, and then it will be brought back. And then we see now people removing their cloaks and putting on the donkey so that Jesus can sit on it. But also we see some people putting it down, the palm tree and all that, so that Jesus can actually walk on them. And these simplify their full submission, their full surrender to this king that ought to be celebrated as king. And this simply symbolize the red carpet that we put today in our king's celebratory functions, you know. And you see our king complaining when they don't get the red carpet. It was so important. Those days, I don't know if our politician will celebrate the act of people putting leaves on the road for them to walk on. But that is exactly what is happening. The event is taking place at Bethany. And this is where the friends of Jesus, Mary, Martha, and Lazarus actually lived. And when you look at the meaning of Bethany, simply means affliction. This resonates with what Jesus was actually to go through at that particular time. But also, if you look around, you realize that Bethany brings some highlight of hopes, because this is where Lazarus was raised from dead. And so this is the same place where Jesus is beginning the journey. Friends, when you read your Bible and you go back to how Jesus actually came to earth, we are reminded of a story of Mary. And just like a movie, you see the appearance of the angel Gabriel to Mary, and she's a bit troubled. And she's expecting Messiah, just like everyone else. But at this particular point, the angel reminds her that you are the one who is going to bring forth Messiah. And don't worry about the name. You don't need to hustle about that, because I am giving you the name. The name Jesus, the name Emmanuel. He will be great. So you should not be troubled of how this child is going to grow. Who is going to become? The child is going to be great. Son of the Most High. He will have the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. The kingdom with no end. And that's why these people knew very well all this statement that is written here. They knew what the angel and the prophecy had been prophesied before about Jesus. And so they knew this is the moment that the king is going to be celebrated. Our problems are going to come to an end. And so Mark 11:9, everybody knew the time was now. The king has come to rule forever. And they shouted, Hosanna. Declaration of praise, but it was actually a plea for salvation, because Hosanna basically means save us, salvation, at that particular point. Our problems are gone. That is what they thought. Blessed is this coming kingdom of our father David, so they say. People anticipated the messianic liberation from the Roman oppression. Jesus tolerated this brief celebration in fulfillment of the prophecy that was said about him. To remove Moi in 202, I think we all found ourselves in that state where the country was ripe and everybody was happy and we were all celebrating and looking forward to a new dawn for this nation. And whether you participated in that celebration at Uhuru Park or at home, I believe at the back of your head, because of the song that were being sung at that particular time, you find yourself singing Yote Yawezekana Bila MOI. We all did that. We all celebrated. But it was short-lived, because after that, you know what followed. Hebrews 13:8, we are told that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And that is the reason why we celebrate him. He never changes. When you read the scriptures from Genesis to Revelation, you don't see anywhere where God has failed to give that which he has promised his people. And so let us look at Christ, the Lord and King. It was very discouraging, I tend to believe. As you read the next verses and the next chapters that come after that, it was very discouraging. It was confusing to see the scene that followed the king who was expected to come. The king who was celebrated at that particular moment, being despised, being rejected, a man of sorrow, acquainted with grief. Is this the right king? Is this the right king? If you look at the story of Jesus, you see the beginning brings so much expectation, so much hope. The end, which is supposed to be the climax, actually leaves people confused, wondering if he was truly a king. And yet through weakness, he is made strong, the king. Indeed, he conquered death. And he's coming back as a king of kings and the Lord of Lords, whose reign will last forever and ever. We see the resurrection of Christ bringing forth a beautiful picture of a true king. A true king whom we should celebrate wherever we are. The head that was once crowned with a thorn is now crowned with glory. Christ the King is no longer limited by time, space, or distance. He is an omnipresent king. Mark helps us to understand what was indeed Christ's destination. Where was he going? Was it just about riding on a donkey and just flossing around, and then that was it? No. The Bible tells us in John 1:14 that the Word became flesh and dwell among us. Dwell here means tabernacle. It tabernacled with us. And so this is just the prophecy that is being fulfilled. Because later on, we are seeing him coming back to cleanse this temple and to turn everything that was being done in this place into a proper place of worship. It seems like Christ had come to see this temple if it is fit for his people to worship, for his people to come and celebrate him as king. Because in a few hours, in a few days, assuming some people say, some commentators say that it was on a Monday, so on a Friday he was going to be crucified. And this is where he was going to make a statement that destroy this temple, and in 3 days I'll be able to bring it back. And so he was coming to see the temple that represents him physically, that people would go and worship in that particular place. Perhaps at first he had come to check if it fulfills the purpose of leading people to a true worship. Hence the coming back for cleansing. As we bring this to an end, what then should we do? What then should we do now that we have understood and we've come to a place that God is revealing to us himself as a Lord and a King who is compassionate and loving? Having this understanding helps us to know how to live a celebratory life, evangelistic life. Because the moment you know the king that you serve is a king who is going to reign forever, when all the kingship here on earth comes to an end, then all you can do is to turn to him and worship him. Turn to him and share him among our people. Our view of the world changes. Hence the reflection is seeing every knee bowing and every tongue confessing that Christ indeed is Lord. And so Paul is identifying with who is to be worshipped in this statement of Romans 14:11. He proclaimed the divine identity of Christ, the King worthy to be worshipped and celebrated. The beauty about this King that we are calling you, brothers and sisters, to celebrate is that he's made himself accessible. His throne is open to all to approach. There's no appointment that you need, as one of our artists would put it. There's not a friend like lowly Jesus. He is a friend. He is our Savior. Yet, he remains that King. That King that we ought to worship. So we come to him with our trouble. We come to him with our joy. We come to him with our praises. We come to him because he cares. Let us celebrate our Lord. Let us celebrate our King. And so Philippians 4:4, again, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I'll say rejoice. Paul again reminds us to celebrate Christ as Lord and King. And this is not dependent on our circumstances. Instead, this is a celebration that is in the Lord based on the trust and in the sovereignty of this living God. That is why we rejoice always, because of that. And so who is Christ to you? Is he worthy to be celebrated? Is he worthy to be praised? Josh McDowell, in his writing, More Than a Carpenter, he says, we only have three alternatives. that will help us decide who this Christ is. It's either Christ is a liar, and when you say he's a liar, the question that you need to ask yourself, how can you lie to the point where you know your lie is leading you to crucifixion and you still stick to it? It becomes difficult, and at that point, you drop it. Another point that he gives, he says that maybe then Christ is a lunatic. And at this point, he says that when you observe, you don't see any abnormalities or imbalances that usually come with mad people. You don't see it in Christ because of his teaching. He was a great teacher. He did great things. And so that one also, we knock it out. And so the only thing that you are left with is that Christ is Lord. And we can only conclude that Christ is Lord because of his claim as the Son of God, as Lord himself. Because that is the only thing that stand and pass the test, the possibility of him becoming who he is, because we've seen it. And today, I believe many of us here, if I pass this microphone and give people opportunity to share something special that Christ has done in your life, that you can actually look back and say, this was Christ, we'll be able to give a testimony that God has revealed himself, not once, not twice, many a time, to show us that indeed he is who we claim to be. He is our Lord and King. Don't you want to know this King? What makes you not to celebrate this King then, if you know he is worth celebratory moments of our lives? Have you met him? The Lord who has revealed himself and made himself visible and accessible to us all. The verse that I know we all know, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes shall not perish, but have everlasting life. That one is open to all of us. It doesn't call people based on color. It doesn't call people based on your wealth. It's just open for all of us. And so today, as you live here, my prayer is that you will celebrate this King. It will be evidence to people who live around you. They'll be able to see you celebrating this King. They'll be able to see you living for this King. In your own closet, when you're alone, when nobody's seeing you, you'll be able to celebrate this King. It will be a lifestyle that you'll be able to show your children, your family, the community around, where you work. You'll be able to celebrate this King. You'll be able to not keep quiet because of understanding who this King is. That when you sit in that matatu, you cannot afford to be quiet to this guy all the way to where you're going. That your first thing will be, do you know about King Jesus? That even here, as we talk about Westlands being a place where we love out loud, it will not be something that we say. It will be something that people will feel, will experience in how we relate with them. And so that will bring many to the kingdom. There is something that was shared yesterday by our elder, and I happen to have watched that clip. And the clip is about what is happening to our nation when one of the people out there are being interviewed. And in that interview, they are saying that the only challenge they are seeing is we have a president who once used to be an evangelist and now is married to somebody who is strongly a believer of Christ. And then we have a deputy president who calls himself a believer also and is married to a bishop. But now they are fighting publicly. Where do we run, us who know nothing about that King? And so you see the kind of hindrance that we bring to the people that we ought to minister to. As believers, there is a lifestyle that we ought to live, a lifestyle of celebrating this King. This King that when you are driving and you are alone in your car and you are playing music, your arms stretch wide, people are wondering, are you mad or something? But you're just celebrating this King because of that music that is playing there or just a song that God has dropped into your mind. And so, Heavenly Father, we want to thank you because of today. Lord, we celebrate you, you, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Father, we want to thank you that you left your kingdom to come and dwell among us, O God. And Father, we want to thank you for how you are drawing us closer to you every now and then, and your Holy Spirit continue to sanctify us, O God. I pray that Heavenly Father, would you help us that every single day of our life, Lord, we'll fix our eyes upon you, Jesus. The Lord indeed will seek you with all our heart, soul, and mind, Lord, that we'll live such a life that will glorify your name. Father, I pray that it will not be a Sunday that we come to celebrate you, but Lord, a Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, all the way to Sunday, every single day will be a moment for us to celebrate you, Lord. When we have or when we have not, Lord, we'll always celebrate you because you are the Lord who deserves our worship and our celebration. And so, Lord, we love you. We love you, Lord, that you are not ashamed to carry all our sin, our sorrow, and our heart, Lord, on that cross. And so, Father, we come before you not ashamed of this gospel. For it is the power of salvation through which, Lord, we are called sons and daughters in this kingdom. And so, Father, I pray that would you minister indeed to the hearts of men and women who are gathered here this morning. Lord, I pray that our lives are not going to be the same again. But, Lord, you are going to take a deeper reflection of ourselves, of how we carry ourselves, of how we interact with the people around us, oh God. Father, we are going to see we are going to be intentional on how to share this gospel, Lord, that many will come to see you. The Lord will not be counted among those who are being pointed as those who belong to Christ and yet are not living for Christ. That Lord will not fall under the category of those who say that, your Jesus I love, but it's this Christianity that I don't. Lord, I pray that we'll be able to live a life that everyone will living around us, Lord, will come and ask, who is this that you worship? What is this that brings joy in your life? What is this that makes you smile even in times of troubles that surrounds you? Because Jesus, you are that King that ought to be celebrated. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Well delivered, Ben. They always say, when somebody speaks like that, you can't add anything. I just urge you to do a rerun of what was on the screens. In your homes, those of you at home, and those of you who are here, go and see what was done. Benjamin, thank you very much for that delivery, and we thank God that you have talk to us that clearly. Now, ladies and gentlemen, earlier on I told you that we are under some financial stress. So now this is the moment for you to generously make your offerings. I ask that you, those making collections, there are many ways of doing this. We have the account on the screen for M-Pesa. There is a collections coming with the ushers. So please, be generous. There are many undertakings we need to do to go forward as Nairobi Baptist, as the whole church, and also in Westlands. So please, give generously. This is designated as our Gift Sunday. So it's basically expected that on a day like this, we give more than we usually should. Usually do, but do this every Sunday. Make every Sunday a gift Sunday. So the ushers, welcome to commence. Thank you. I forgot to invite you. I was wondering how I was going to stand here and wait for the collection to happen.
So even as we join in the same song, as we continue to also just exalt the name of Christ, kindly join us in this song.
Wonderful.
merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend, Wood of love, that Lamb, rescue the souls of men. Oh, you rescue the souls of men.
Again.
Redeemer and friend, who'd have thought that the Lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men.
You were the one.
You are the one that we praise.
You are the one we adore.
That we praise. You're the one that our hearts adore, O God. And Lord, thank you for allowing us to worship you through our giving. Lord, we thank you that you're the one who fills our cup day by day. And Lord, thank you that we can bring our offerings, our tithes, our gifts, our first fruits to you this morning, O God. Lord, we thank you. And Lord, we pray that these gifts shall be used to advance your kingdom and the gospel in the name of Jesus. Lord, may you bless your people. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'd like us to appreciate our service leader today, Elder Bill Rahedi. Yes, we thank God for you and your family. I can see Mrs. Rahedi somewhere there. Audrey, we celebrate you and your family. May the Lord bless you as you continue serving the church. I'd also like to make mention that we had a few of us who graduated, but they were taking the classes at NBC Ngong Road. We usually have the virtual classes, yet some churches choose to have it in person. So the virtual classes were on Tuesdays, and our virtual classes were on Saturdays. So they thought Saturday can be tricky, and so they joined the NBC Ngong Road. That is our other elder, Elder Lucy Kambuni. Kindly stand as we celebrate you. Yes, she was able to graduate for the 318 this year as well. We have Mam Veronica Muya, who was also a group leader at NBC Ngong Road. She passed her love. She went to get the certificate for her group in Ngong Road. And then we had Mam Hulda Conchella, who also graduated yesterday at NBC Ngong Road. We celebrate you, Mam. God bless you. I'd like us to stand as we bring our service to a close. Thank you, Pastor Benjamin, for sharing the words of God. And I liked what he was able to say, that there was a declaration of praise. And at the mention of this name, Jesus, every knee will bow. Every knee bows to this name. And I'd like to extend, if you're here and you know you have not bowed to the authority of our Lord and King, I'd like to invite you to just take some time, meet with us. We will lead you to knowing Jesus, so that when we mention the name Jesus, when we celebrate, we can celebrate together. We can celebrate our Lord and King, who every knee must bow. So you'd rather choose to bow on this side of the earth, because at the mention of the name Jesus, when the time comes and the trumpet calls us to obey, every knee has to bow. May the Lord minister to all of us as we celebrate him. Ephesians chapter 3 verse 20 to 21. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen. Let us enjoy as we go out to celebrate this King, this Lord. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. His glory is from now. His dominion is from everlasting to everlasting. The Lord bless you. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen.